Welcome to EPG Pathshala. This afternoon, we are dealing with the art and architecture of India, and the particular module that we are going to discuss right now is the Sultanate architecture of Bengal, Jaunpur, and Malwa. And let me introduce myself. I am Dr. Shutapa Sinha, Department of Islamic History and Culture, University of Calcutta. So, since we are learning on the art and architecture of India or the Delhi Sultanate, and in this module we are going to learn about the regional style of Indo-Islamic architecture. In the first module we have discussed about the imperial style of Indo-Islamic architecture, which is under the module name Delhi Sultanate architecture. But in here we are going to discuss about the regional architecture, the region or the regional kingdom, provincial kingdom, which were under the ruling of Delhi Sultanate initially, and later on they became independent and ruled independently in their own kingdoms. So now we are going to discuss about Bengal Sultanate, Jaunpur Sultanate, and Malwa Sultanate. Since Bengal was almost contemporary with Delhi, so we are going to first discuss about Bengal Sultanate, which started in early 13th century and continued till 16th century. Then we will talk about Jaunpur Sultan, and then we will talk about the Malwa Sultans. So chronologically, after Multan, Bengal is the home of the first provincial style of Indo-Islamic architecture, as I have already mentioned, and as elsewhere Bengal too, there is a new style of Islamic architecture which is essentially arcuate, and it came into existence. Also, it incorporated some of the traviated feature. But a strong local traditions of this particular, the easterly province of India, had its own impact on this architecture. The mosques and tombs were built following the Muslim design, but with that they have also incorporated the local traditions or the local features, and which was essentially made according to the climatic condition and the geographical situation of this particular area. Now we are going to discuss about the characteristic features of the Bengal architectures. It has a very distinct curvilinear cornice and roof covering the mosque and other structures. Here we need to have a curvilinear roof of any of the building. It actually followed the local tradition of the bamboo huts, which has got the curvilinear roof because Bengal had always a heavy downpour or heavy rains. So to wave off the extra water volume, they need to have a curvilinear roof rather than a flat roof. Thick and heavy short square pillars of stone and columns of brick are essential features. Shallow paneling of the walls and their rich terracotta ornamentation is of great elegance. Rich and profuse surface decoration by colored glaze tiles also introduced during the 15th century of Bengal architecture. But as a whole, the fusion of both the styles did not prove very satisfactory, but of course an unique feature of Bengal. The building activities of Bengal actually started from early part of the 13th century, when the early Muslim rulers started their governorship from Bengal, and they were deputed actually by the Delhi Sultan. So it was very likely that they followed the pattern which was initiated by the Delhi rulers. The period of 300 centuries, we have divided into it in three phases. The early phase of the Muslim rulers, that is the governor's period, it is almost from 1205 to 1339. Next is the second period, which is the period of the independent sultans, that is of the Ilyashahi rulers and their immediate successors. They ruled from 1339 up to 1442, almost for 100 years. And the last period we have designated as of later Ilyashahis, Hussein Shahis, and the Afghan rulers, that is from 1442 to 1576, before the Mughals came. The center of the political authority, of course, was for the first period, it was in Gaur, present day in Malda district of West Bengal. No monument of that very early age survived in Malda, but of course in the district of South Bengal, that is in Hooghly, like a place in Tribeni, we find the earliest example of Indo-Islamic architecture of Bengal, which we all popularly know as Jafar Khan Ghazi's mosque and madrasa, the tomb of Jafar Khan Ghazi and the mosque of Jafar Khan Ghazi. It was built in and around 1292, that is the end of 13, almost at the end of 13th century. But if we are talking about the second phase, the main or principal phase of the independent sultans of Bengal, the most important monument of this period is the Adina Mosque, and it was constructed by Sikandar Shah, the son of Ilyas Shah, at their new capital at Pandua, which is also in the present Malda district of West Bengal. This Adina Mosque is remarkable for its considerable size, having a very large and open courtyard. It was surrounded on all sides by cloisters formed by 88 archways. The whole building is covered by 378 identical small domes. This is to be mentioned here that this Adina Mosque in Pandua, it is the second largest mosque in Asia and the largest mosque in India, if I am not wrong. And all the archways of this mosque are almost of similar design, except the one in the large yuan-like barrel vaulted hall in the center. The center prayer hall, it is absolutely covered by a huge rectangular barrel vault, unlike the other domical areas or the structures and the aisles of the mosque. There is, however, not a single entrance gateway of such magnitude and such elegance like the mosque it has. These factors impart to the whole of the building a monotonous appearance. Only for the central nave or the prayer hall that we have mentioned has got barrel vault. And another important feature is the Badshah Ki Takht, which is on the northern part of the mosque. It has a gallery. The floor of the gallery is wooden and it is known as Badshah Ki Takht. It could be the royal gallery or it could be a separate gallery for the ladies folk of the royal family. This is actually the Badshah Ki Takht, and the pillar in the lower story are very elegant but of usual proportion. It's very squat in shape. The domes of this mosque are supported by pendentives. Bricks have been set diagonally in every third course of the pendentives, and the very elegantly looking Badshah Ki Takht of Adina Mosque is of course a very remarkable feature of this period. We find a similar mosque of later period in Gaur. We will discuss it later on. Just after the Ilyas Shahi dynasty, there came a interim period of a Hindu Raja called Raja Ganesh, and his son Jalaluddin Muhammad, he again established the Islamic kingdoms in Bengal. And we find that ruler, the son of Raja Ganesh, he was converted into Islam and took the name as Jalaluddin Muhammad Shah. His tomb is actually the first example of Islamic architecture in Bengal, which actually adopted the regional style, the regional motifs and regional techniques of building activity. That is known as the Eklaki tomb at Pandua, which was built in and around 1425. It represents the true character of the regional style of Bengal, and this tomb is a simple and refined square structure. First use of carved cornice we find here, supporting on a plain hemispherical dome. It lacks in height and thereby suffer from want of dignity. The tomb is richly carved with octagonal corner turrets, and its beautiful surface terracotta decoration in low relief is first of its kind in this part. So here we find the Eklaki tomb, which is a square monument and covered by a hemispherical dome, and have got the curvilinear roof for the first time. Very similar monument that we find in the second capital, the capital again shifted to Gaur. So here again we find the Chika monument, which is almost similar to that Eklaki tomb that we have just mentioned. And here another gateway to the royal fort is on the right hand side below, which is almost similar to the same type of this group of architecture, which named as Gumti Gate. We find some local mosque. There are several, a number of mosques which are strewn over this capital of Gaur. This capital city, it was founded around 1450, and it continued up to the end of the Sultanate period in Bengal, that is in the last quarter of the 16th century. This Chamkati mosque building is a very small mosque of square type, basically of square type, and they have a all these mosques in Bengal, they can be divided into two distinct plan. One having square and single dome structure, and the other is oblong with multi-domed ones. The number of domes corresponding to the number of entrances as well as the bays and aisles. Octagonal towers are at angles, curvilinear roof, rich and elaborate terracotta ornamentation, and sometimes rather in the later times terracotta decoration are with glazed tiles and glazed bricks, stone facing of walls. Those became very common feature of the architecture of this period. We are still talking about the architecture of the 15th century in Bengal. We can always have secular buildings other than the religious buildings like mosques and tombs that we have discussed till now. So we have a secular monument that is a darwaza or the gateway to the royal fort, which is known as Dakhil Darwaza, which is a magnificent and imposing gateway. It is built entirely with brick, and terracotta surface decoration is also there. It's considered to be an example of the perfect surface decoration on a monument, and it is a perfect example of brick architecture, displaying an excellent proportion of structural and decorative features. So here we find the Dakhil Darwaza, the gateway, and having a vaulted entrance way. You can see the main entrance way, it is a vaulted one, and on the corner we can find the bastion like turrets. However, again we are coming back to the mosque architecture. The mosques, which are rectangular in plan and have a multiple dome, have somewhat a low facade. Pointed arches and as doorways and a slightly carved top is a very common feature. Their arches are raised on brick piers or stone pillars. They have octagonal small turrets at the corners. Namely, we have several mosques like this. So we can name them as Tatipara Mosque, Chamkati Mosque, Latan Mosque, Chika, etc., etc. So here we find that Tatipara, the famous Tatipara Mosque, the domes of which have totally been disappeared now. So the entire structure is built by brick and with profusely decorated terracotta ornamentation. And next is at Latan Mosque, which is very peculiar and unique in character. It is of course square in plan, having a central dome on the central prayer hall, but the smaller cupolas or domes are covering the front veranda. And among these three domes, they have also got a four chala or four inclined roofs, that is a local influence that is called the chat chala, which we find in the Bengali huts. Another interesting monument of this period is the Firoz Minar, which is also at Gaur. This is also a victory minar, like we find in case of Qutub Minar in Delhi. It's all, of course, it's not comparable in size. This is also a five-story tower, the lower three stories of which are 12-sided, and the above two stories are circular in diameter. Its surface decoration is in brick and terracotta, and we can also find the use of colored glazed tiles, which show that it was built towards the close of the 15th century. And the Minar is also on the high plinth, which can be, that's why it is approached by a flight of steps and stairs in front of it. And in every stories you find the entrance doorways, and it has got a staircase which is not a flat staircase, but now the entry is restricted, so nobody can enter into the or at the top of the Minar. So, however, while we are coming to the 16th century, a number of lavishly ornamented mosques we find both in Gaur and also in the suburbs of the Gaur, which is called Firozpur, which is presently in the country of Bangladesh, which falls in Bangladesh. So, we will look at Borosona Mosque at Gaur, Chotosona Mosque or the Small Golden Mosque at Firozpur in Bangladesh, which is actually, which was actually the suburb of the principal capital city. We will find a mosque at Bagha in Rajshahi district, also in Bangladesh. We find a Kadam Rasul Mosque, or rather a monument which housed the footprint of the Rasul, are mainly built of brick and terracotta at Gaur. Their style illustrates the gradual decadence of the building activity in Bengal. The Chotosona Mosque or the Small Golden Mosque and the Great Golden Mosque are multi-domed, and the domes were originally actually gilded with in golden color, and that's why they are named as Gold Mosque or Golden Mosque. So, this is Borosona Mosque from outside, entirely cased by the basalt stone, and the domes were gilded earlier. And inside the mosque, there were, Borosona Mosque, the main central hall, there are several pillars. So, the bays and archways and the aisles were almost 15 in number. The Chotosona Mosque is far smaller in size than Borosona, and it has a Bengali dome in the middle of its many domes of usual pattern. Its stone walls are carved in low relief, which has got rich foliated design. Chotosona Mosque actually is very similar to that of the Latin Mosque which was built at the end of 15th century. Chotosona is presently in Bangladesh. This is what we are talking about, the Kadam Rasul building. It is not a mosque, but a building or a monument which houses the holy footprint of the Prophet. And of course, it is decorated with huge or rich ornamented terracotta ornamentation, and thereby we came to the end of Bengal architecture, provincial architecture. And now we are talking about another Sultanate architecture, which was again in Uttar Pradesh, close to Delhi, and it which was actually started during the time of the Tughlaqs of the Delhi Sultanate. This was a very short-lived Sultanate period, but brilliant line of Tughlaq appointed governors who were known actually as the Sharkis of the Jaunpur. The Sharki Sultans of Jaunpur ruled over that part of the country for about a century, and the Sultans of Jaunpur the Sultanate Kingdom of Jaunpur was founded by Malik Sarawar, who had risen to power after the death of Firoz Shah Tughlaq in 1388 AD. So, from the beginning of the 15th century, Jaunpur became a very prominent Sultanate kingdom, and the architectural activity also are of remarkable merit. A considerable number of monuments were erected, and they have formed their a class by themselves. Many of Jaunpur monuments are generally believed to have been destroyed by Sikandar Lodi. So, therefore, whatever we find today are mostly the religious monuments, that is the mosques. And there is a little doubt that the Sharki style was strongly influenced by the Tughlaqs of the Delhi Sultanate. If we take up in short that the characteristic features, what are the characteristic features of Jaunpur architecture, we may say that the mosques are all open courtyard style, surrounded by cloisters on three sides. The arcuate and trabeate styles both are seen side by side. Arches, walls and domes were employed freely. Short square pillars with bracket capitals, horizontal architraves can be found, which are again of trabeate style. Carved roofs were employed in the cloisters. The most typical feature is the huge imposing pro pylon screens. Elegance may also be seen in the plain treatment of the square pillars, rough execution of the bracket capitals, and finally the finely chiseled perforated stone screens, which are very commonly found, could be an impact or influence of the Gujarat architecture. Now, before going into the religious or the architecture of Jaunpur, we can have a quick glance over the fort architecture of Jaunpur, which is actually built in the last or the fag end of 14th century by the Tughlaq Sultans, and this is the entrance of the fort of Jaunpur fort. And also a mosque which is of course predates the Sharkis of the Jaunpur, but of course contemporary with the Tughlaqs of the Delhi. When we are talking about the religious architecture, which is particularly belong to the Sharki period of Jaunpur, we have to mention about the Otola Mosque, which is the earliest and finest example of the Sharki style. It conforms to the general plan of the open courtyard style, which is enclosed on the west by the prayer hall, and on the remaining three sides of it are enclosed by the cloisters, which were actually used as the madrasa or the learning centers. Many of its features are directly borrowed from the Tughlaq style, and the Otola Mosque is distinguished by the originally displayed in the composition of its various parts. This is the huge courtyard, open courtyard of Otola Masjid, and in front of that we can see the huge propylon of the center entrance to the mosque, or directly to the prayer hall, which is flanked by two other pylons which are much smaller in size. The center one is the main to the facade. So this facade is composed of altogether three impressive pylons. The central one is the huge one and the gigantic one. It consists of a lofty recessed arch set within two square sloping towers. The sides of the whole structure are relieved by smaller arched niches. Stone screened windows are also been found. The propylon is a great architectural success, and it conceals from view the dome covering the central hall of the mosque. Here again we are talking about two more comparatively insignificant mosques. One is the Khalis Mukhlis Mosque, which is popularly known as Char Ungli Mosque, which is very simple in plan, and it's a very plain structure without much architectural merit. And the next one is as we call it the Jhanjri Mosque or Jinjiri Mosque. Actually, there is nothing but the central pylon that exists today, but that is exquisitely carved one, and it deserves special mention. Another mosque what we find, this is also a Jami mosque, it's called Lal Darwaza Mosque, which was built during the reign of Ibrahim Shah Sharki's successor Mahmud Shah Sharki in 1440 to 57 was the reign period, and it was designed on a somewhat smaller scale after the Otola Mosque, but definitely with few changes. And people generally say that this Lal Darwaza Mosque was built by the Queen of Mahmud Shah. The prayer hall here in this Lal Darwaza Mosque is covered by only one dome instead of three domes as we find in Otola Mosque. Also, the facade has only one propylon, and moreover the single pylon is lower as compared to its width. And the prayer hall here, the prayer hall inside is also a bit different from what we have seen in case of Otola Mosque. Here again we find that a place which is covered by the stone jali or stone lattice is again, we may say, that the ladies gallery, which was meant for the prayer for the ladies folk of the royal family. Evidently, this Otola Mosque served as a model to the largest and the last great monument of Jaunpur. It is a Jami Masjid built by Hussain Shah Sharki, the last of the Sharki rulers who ruled during 1458 to 79 AD. And the Jami Mosque shows certain distinct signs of improvement than the Otola Masjid. And the entire structure is raised on a lofty plinth provided with an imposing flight of steps for approach in front. We can see the entrance with huge flight of steps and having a courtyard inside, and the courtyard is open courtyard having entrances on its three sides. All of them are quite magnificent in nature. And while we are talking about Jami Mosque of Jaunpur, the facade is having only one pylon in the center instead of three, as we have seen in case of Otola Masjid. And you can see that the propylon is covering or hiding the dome. The entrance hall of this main center prayer hall of this Jami Masjid is very unique in nature and character, as because it has got a single dome, and on the side wings these are covered by vaults, single vaults they have been covered. Instead of dome they have been covered by vaults, and that those without any pillars, support of any pillars. So Jami Mosque on the whole lacks the architectural effect of Otola Mosque, but it is of course unique and unique in character and huge in style. And hope we don't have much to say about Jaunpur architecture. This is all that we can mention about Jaunpur style. And here we can see that the huge dome, central dome of the Jami Mosque on the left hand side, and on our right hand side we can see the vault structure. The entire side wings of the mosque is covered by a vault without support of any single pillar, and that is very unique and distinguished feature of this mosque, and that made it very distinct. Now we are coming to the another provincial architectural style which was developed by the Sultans of Malwa, and this Malwa is situated in the central province, that is present day Madhya Pradesh in India. And the Sultans of Malwa, they were the governors of Delhi like any other provincial sultanate, but with the coming of in the early years of the 15th century this Malwa also became independent. Its rulers had their capital first at a place called Dhar and then at Mandu. Malwa does not possess any outstanding monument of early period, that means when it was under the governorship of the Delhi sultans, it did not have any outstanding monument. And the existing Islamic monuments of Dhar and Mandu all date from the 15th century only. Malwa style of Islamic architecture is of course arcuate in nature, but in the beginning they have some kind of trabeated feature. We will see in the photographs. It features like battering walls, pointed arch with stylized butt fringe, arch and lintel, the dome and the pyramidal roof, etc., were obviously borrowed from the Tughlaq style and the Lodi style of Delhi. The Malwa style is also marked by some features and motifs of its own. It has got skillful and elegant use of the arched pillar and beam. High plinths and lofty terrace of the building is a very common feature. Fine masonry, frequent use of domed cupolas round a central dome, and restrained ornamentation is also another feature. The minaret of the mosques is totally absent in Malwa. In its first phase, the Malwa style is essentially one of the improvisation stage, that is between the beginning of the 15th century. Certain new features have also been introduced. Pillars and stones of pre-Islamic buildings were put together to form the entire mosque. Attempts were also made to bring about a composite structure with pillars and domes. Here you can see it's called, there are several mosques like this, two in Dhar that we can mention. One is Kamal Maula Mosque and another one is Bhojshala. Both of these mosques are very similar in nature. You can see it has got flat roof supported by series of pillars. Pillars are mostly carved with pre-Islamic, in pre-Islamic feature type without figures, and you have seen a very low height shallow dome which is covering the central mihrab area. And in one of the photograph we can see the inside of the shallow dome, which has been prepared not maintaining the true principles of forming a dome construction. However, in Dilawar Khan Mosque at Mandu and the Khalis Mukhlis Mosque, another mosque is Khalis Mukhlis, but these four mosques are almost in the same nature and same feature, having a low flat roof supported by the pillars. Within a few years, the capital was shifted from Dhat to Mandu, and it began the second phase of the architectural style in Mandu, which is actually the real Malwa style. The buildings became very massive but sober and original in character. Some of them are particularly noted for their impressive grandeur. This phase is represented by the Delhi and Tarapur gateways of the fort, the Jami Masjid, the Ashrafi Mahal buildings, the tomb of Hoshangshah and the tomb of Darya Khan and other rulers of the Malwa, and Hindola Mahal and Jahaj Mahal. Jami Masjid is the largest constructed mosque in early Tughlaq period of Malwa. It consists of a square courtyard bound on four sides by arched cloisters, two bays deep on the east and three bays deep on the north and south, and five bays deep on the west, that is on the prayer hall side or the Qibla wall side. The lofty plinth of the mosque has arched chambers or cells as to cover it, and the entrance porch on the east is approached by wide ascending steps. It was once decorated with exquisitely colored borders and panels in glazed tiles. The mosque is built mostly in the arch and vault style. It is simple, its simple grandeur is expressive of power and strength. Another feature of this Jami Mosque of Mandu is that it has got a very exquisitely carved mihrab, the central mihrab. You can see on the slide that there are a combination of two colors of stone along with white marble, black stone, and colored tiles have also been used to build the central mihrab. It's very elegant in style, and the minbar also, the stepped minbar to read the azan, is also very elegant in nature. This is the Jami Masjid's entrance, which is placed on a high steps, on a high plinth of, range of steps, and the walls of the cloisters, which are very slanting or batter in formation. At the back of this Jami Mosque, it lies the tomb of Hoshangshah, the first tomb in its nature, which is absolutely square in plan. It was completed in and about 1440, and this distinguishing feature of this stern looking monument is that extensive use of white marble. The entire monument is covered or faced by a finely cut or dressed white marble. Wide expanse of its dome and construction of an additional terrace with four cupolas between the dome and the lower square chamber set the example for the tomb architecture for remaining years, even till the Mughals. We can have also other tombs like Darya Khan's tomb and Dai Ki Maqbara, which are simple square in plan but has a octagonal drum base of the dome. Another group of buildings is called Ashrafi Mahal group of building, which is in ruins but the remains testify to their original beauty and grandeur. Now we are entering into the royal enclave, which is a fortified enclave and having several monuments which are basically different parts of the palaces, like the Hindola Mahal, which was probably intended as an assembly hall and royal apartments. It is an unusual massive and solid structure, T-shaped in plan, very unique. Its thick and sharply battering walls, shapely tall and narrow pointed arches outside and wide arches within Oriel windows and perforated stone screen in delicate and elegant pattern are some of the features which made Hindola Mahal quite pleasing and interesting to look at. The last outstanding monument of the Malwa style is the Jahaj Mahal, which is also in the royal enclave, which is standing between the two small lakes. It is a long two-storied building with a facade of well-proportioned tall pointed arches. The ground story is divided into halls, corridors and baths, while on the roof are pavilions and kiosks. So these are all examples of the secular building which were built by the sultans of Malwa, and these are particularly noble for the homogeneity of its composition and the proportion of its different parts. Its fine arched halls and roof pavilion with beautiful domes, kiosk, balconies and the water courses are very interesting to look at. We can see that Ashrafi Mahal buildings, the Hindola Mahal with its battering or sloping wall on outside, which is overlooking a lake in front of that. This is the top of the, this is Jahaj Mahal, that is a ship. They have compared it with the shape of a ship and having the waterworks. It is in fact marks the beginning of the third and the final phase of the Malwa style, Jahaj Mahal. But it reflecting an immense love for pleasure and luxurious life that was the spirit of the age. The buildings during this phase took the form of palaces with Turkish baths, pavilions, summer houses, fountains, etc. These buildings were usually erected near some lake or on hilltops and mainly consisted of a courtyard with pools and fountains enclosed by a series of arcaded halls on the ground floor and open arched verandas above them with fluted domes. Now we will have a look of the buildings like Baj Bahadur's palace, which were originally constructed in 1508 by Nasiruddin Khalji, and the pavilion or palace of Rani Rupmati, Nilkant Palace, Kaliadaha Mahal, etc. But most famous are Baj Bahadur's palace and Rupmoti's palace. We'll have a look of that, and you can see that inside the palace there is a pool, water pool, and inside the courtyard, in fact, in case of Baj Bahadur's palace. In case of Rani Rupmati's palace, it is also on a hill. Both of them are on situated on a hilltop, and at the ground floor we found that the arcaded veranda or hall of the ground floor, that is a very typical in nature. Nilkant Palace is not of that important, but it is of course of following the same characteristic feature, and there we come to an end with the Malwa style of architecture. So as a whole, if we summarize the entire module that we have discussed today, that is the three regional architectural style, starting with Bengal and then to Jaunpur and Malwa, these three provincial kingdoms were very important and made their mark on the politically on the Delhi Sultanate, on the political history of Delhi Sultanate, as well as the cultural history of Delhi Sultanate in particular and India in general. So these are this Delhi, starting with Delhi Sultanate as an imperial style, and then we have followed the three regional styles. These are mainly representing the new type of architecture that we call as Indo-Islamic architecture, which is very unique not only in Asia but throughout the world. Thank you so very much. But for your further study and further reference, you may go to the e-text of the EPG Pathshala and the references and the glossaries. Thank you very much.